Good morning, dear students. In 9th biology, today we are going to learn about in chapter 6 tissues. Topics covered in this lessons are introduction or plants and animals made of same types of tissues, plant tissues or meristematic and permanent tissues, animal tissues or epithelial, connective, muscular and nervous tissue. Introduction. The cell is the fundamental structural and functional unit of life. We all know that the cell is the basic structural and functional unit of life. Why the cell is known as the basic structural and functional unit of life? Because cells makes up the bodies of all living organism, or each and every living organism are formed from a single cell. So that's why the cell is known as the basic structural and functional unit of life. Next one is, how many cells do you think an organism needs to live? 1 or 100 or thousands? Well, that is depends on the organism. In unicellular organism, a single cell performs all basic function. Unicellular organism means an organism which is made up of only a single cell. That is called a unicellular organism. But in multicellular organism, there are millions of cells. Multicellular organism means an organism which is made up of many cells. Such type of organism are called as multicellular organism. Amoeba is an unicellular organism because it is made up of only a single cell. That single cell constitutes the whole body of an amoeba, and also that single cell carry all the functions of an organism like digestion, respiration, locomotion, etc. What about a plant or a human being? Is single cell enough for a plant or a human being? Of course not. They need millions of cells to make up their entire body. So there are millions of cells in multicellular organism. That cells are formed as different group of cells, each group of cells to carry out specific functions. For example, in multicellular organism, a particular function is carried out by cluster of cells. That cluster of cells are called tissues. Definition of tissue: a group of cells that are similar in structure and work together to achieve a particular function. Otherwise, we can say a group of cells that are originated from the same region. They are similar in structure and all the cells are working together to achieve a particular or specific function, that is known as tissue. Next topic is, are plants and animals made up of same type of tissues? The nature of life in animals and plants are different. Do you think plants have tissues? Yes, all the plants have tissues. Is it similar to animal or human tissues? No. Why? Because means they are totally different. They are totally different with each other based on their requirements, structure and functions. So plants have different types of requirements and animals or human beings have different types of requirements. For example, plants are stationary. They don't move from one place to another. To stand in an erect position or in upright position, the plants need large quantity of supportive tissue. Most of the supportive tissue in plants are made up of dead cells, whereas in animals or in human beings are not stationary. They need to move from one place to another for searching of food or for shelter or for many other purpose. So they need more energy, or they need lot of energy. Hence, most of the cells in animals are living cells. Plant tissue. There are two types of plant tissue: meristematic tissue and permanent tissue. First one is meristematic tissue. It is also known as growing tissue. This is ever growing or most active tissue in the plants or meristematic tissue. It helps for growth of plants. So, based on the region where they are present, the meristematic tissue is further divided into three types based on their location. First one is apical meristem, intercalary meristem, and lateral meristem. So, types of meristematic tissue, first one is apical meristem. So, apical meristem means it is present in the tip of the stem and the tip of the root. It is responsible for the vertical growth of plants. So, the apical meristem is only responsible for the vertical growth of plants. That vertical growth is also known as primary growth. Second one is intercalary meristem. So, intercalary meristem, it is present at the base of the leaves as well as in the internode region. It is also helps for the vertical growth of plants. Third one is lateral meristem. So, lateral meristem is also known as cambium. So, lateral meristem is responsible for the lateral growth or secondary growth of plants. That means horizontal growth. It is helps for or helps to increase the girth on width of the plants. It is found only in the lateral region. Second one is permanent tissue. So, for example, the meristematic tissue, which is present in the tip of the stem, gets divide and form many new cells. Due to this, the plants will grow after some time or after some days. The old meristematic tissue, which is present beyond the tip of the stem, becomes permanent tissue. So, that older meristematic tissues are converted into permanent tissue. So, once it converted into permanent tissue means it loses their dividing capacity and get matured. So, that process is called differentiation. These cells lose the ability of divide and gets permanent shape and size. So, to getting permanent shape and size of cells is called differentiation. So, there are two types of permanent tissue. One is simple permanent tissue. Second one is complex permanent tissue. So, first one is simple permanent tissue. It is located just under the epidermis. That means just beneath the outer covering of the plants. The common simple permanent tissue is parenchyma tissue. Simple permanent tissue means it has only one kind of cells. Mostly the cells are spherical in shape. They all are living cells with consist of thin cell wall. The cells in parenchyma tissue. So there are three types of simple permanent tissue: parenchyma, colenchyma, and sclerenchyma. First one is parenchyma. The cells in parenchyma tissue are loosely arranged. Due to that, it has large intercellular space. So intercellular space means the space between cells. That is called the intercellular space. This type of tissue mostly used for that parenchyma tissue are mostly used for storing food. If the parenchyma tissue contain chlorophyll, means such type of parenchyma tissues are called chlorenchyma. It involves in the process of photosynthesis. Second type is aranchyma. If the parenchyma tissue contain air cavities, means such type of parenchyma tissues are called aranchyma. So, it is mostly especially present in the aquatic plants. This parenchyma tissues are used for aquatic plants to float in the water. So such type of parenchyma tissues are called parenchyma. Second one is colenchyma. Second type of simple permanent tissue is colenchyma. So colenchyma, it provides flexibility to the plants. Colenchyma is mainly used for the flexibility of plants. So it is also living cells. The parenchyma cells are living cells and colenchyma cells are living cells. The parenchyma cells are spherical in shape, but in colenchyma cells are elongated in shape. Elongated as elongated cells. So the colenchyma cells have deposition of cellulose only at the corner of the cell. Only at the corner of the cell, so that the walls are uneven. They are vertically tightly packed. They are very tightly packed and have less intercellular space. But in parenchyma tissue, there are lot of intercellular space. But in colenchyma, there is very less intercellular space. Since they have thickened at the corner, they are mainly used for to providing mechanical support to the plants. The colenchyma cells are present in young dicot stem, petioles, midrib of dicot leaves, etc. And third one is sclerenchyma. So it is a third type of simple permanent tissue. It is also simple permanent tissue. That means it is made up of only one type of cells. These cells have thick and tough secondary walls. It is made up of lignin, which is providing hardness to the cell. Because of lignin, the cells are more strong and tough. For example, the husk or outer covering of coconut is made up of sclerenchyma. Next one is, there are another two types of tissues in plants. One is epidermis and second one is cork. First one is epidermis. The outermost layer, this is called epidermis. So the outermost layer is known as epidermis. Generally, epidermis cells are arranged very closely the epidermal cells or secrete. The epidermis means it is the outermost layer in plants. Sometimes the epidermis has a single layer and sometimes it may have several layers. The several layers of epidermis are formed like a sponge. It prevents the excessive water loss. The entire surface of plants are covered by epidermis. So these epidermal cells or secrete a waxy substance are known as cutin. So this cutin spread over the outer surface of the plant and form a thin layer called the cuticle. So the epidermal cells secrete a waxy substance that is called cutin. So that cutin is form a layer that is called the cuticle layer. So this cuticle is a water resistant layer. It is also provide resistant against bacteria and some other disease causing organism like fungi. So next one is, so epidermal layer is a continuous layer without any intercellular space. Cells are mostly in flat in shape. Outer side is more thicker than the inner side. So sometimes the small pores in leaf are known as pores. In epidermal layer, there is a small pores in leaf are known as stomata. Mostly it is located in the back side of the leaf. These pores are enclosed by two kidney-shaped cells or called cord cells. So, this is the stomata. This stomata is mostly present in the back side of the leaf. These pores are enclosed by two kidney-shaped cells or known as cord cells or known as God cells. So, God cells are specialized epidermal cells. God cells are the specialized epidermal cells. So, next one is corks. So, this stomata is mainly used for the process of transpiration. So, it helps for the transpiration. Transpiration means water loss in the plants. So, second tissue is cork. Cork in higher plants or in woody plants, the outermost tissue in stems are transformed into a specialized productive tissue called cork. That cork cells are dead cells. All the cork cells are dead cells. It does not have intercellular space. The walls of cork cells are more thickened by the deposition of seborrheic. So the walls of cork cells are more thickened by the deposition of seborrheic. So next type of permanent tissue is complex permanent tissue. So, simple permanent tissue means it is made up of only one type of cell. So, all the cells are same type. But whereas in complex permanent tissue, the tissue is made up of different types of cells. So, it is called as complex permanent tissue. All these different types of cells coordinate together and performs a common function. So there are two types of complex permanent tissue. Mostly the complex permanent tissue means the tissue is made up of different types of cells. It also contains thick and thin cell wall. There are two types of complex permanent tissue. One is xylem and second one is phloem. Xylem is mainly used for water transportation and phloem are used for food transportation. There are four types of cell in xylem. First one is tracheids, vessels, xylem parenchyma, xylem fiber. In that, except xylem parenchyma, all the cells are dead cells. So only the xylem parenchyma is the living cells in xylem. Other tracheids, vessels and xylem fiber are the dead cells. There's a xylem mainly used for water transportation. So it absorbs the water and minerals from root and it supply the water to other parts of the plants. In other words, it can be said that the water pipes of the plants. So xylem is also known as water pipes of the plants. The fluid transported in xylem is called as xylem sap. Water flows in xylem is unidirectional. It also provides mechanical support to the plants because it has many dead cells. Tracheids is a dead cells, vessels is a dead cells and xylem fiber is a dead cell. Due to that, it provides mechanical support to the plants. So next one is phloem. So phloem is made up of five types of cells, that is sieve cells, sieve tubes, companion cells, phloem fiber and phloem parenchyma. So in that, the phloem fiber only is the dead cell, only a dead cell in phloem. So phloem is mainly used for food transportation in the plants. Next one is animal tissues. So animal tissues. Let's study about various types of animal tissues in detail. In case of animal, where the body is expected to perform numerous functions simultaneously, for that the animals need large number of tissues. So in human bodies or in animals, there are large number of animal tissues are present. For simplicity, we divide the animal tissues into four categories depending upon the upon their function. First one is epithelial tissue. Second one is connective tissue. Third one is muscular tissue. Fourth one is nervous tissue. So there are four categories of animal tissues based on their function. First one is epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscular tissue, and nervous tissue. First one is epithelial tissue. Epi means above. So these epithelial tissue or lies above the entire body and forms the protective covering. So that is nothing but the skin. It covers and protects the internal and external surface of the entire animal body. So the covering and protective tissues in the animal body are epithelial tissue. It helps to keep separate the different body organs. So next one is, most of the body consists of epithelial tissue. Most of our body consists of epithelial tissue. It is the main function. Its main function is protection and covering. The function of epithelial tissue is protection and covering. So other function of epithelial tissue is, it acts as a barrier between the various organs and separating them. For example, every organs like heart, lungs, liver are covered by the layer of epithelial tissue. So they can easily separate with each other. The example of epithelial tissue are the skin, the lining of mouth, lining of blood vessels, lung alveoli, kidney tubules. These are all made up of epithelial tissues. So since it has to form a protective layer, there is no intercellular space between the cells. So the cells are closely and tightly packed and form a continuous layer. So epithelial cells are arranged in a continuous layer. So next one is types of epithelial tissue. Based on the structure and number of layers, they are divided into four types. So types of epithelial tissue. First one is squamous epithelium. Second one is cuboidal epithelium. First one is squamous epithelium, second one is cuboidal epithelium, third one is columnar epithelium, and fourth one is glandular epithelium. First one is squamous epithelium. So based on number of layer, it is divided into simple and stratified as a two types. Squamous means, squama means scales of fish. Squama means scales of fish. So squamous epithelial cells are in scales of fish shapes. So it is a shape of scales of fish. So next one is cuboidal epithelium. So it has cube shaped cells. Third one is columnar epithelium. So columnar epithelium means it has pillar shaped cells. First one is squamous epithelium. So squamous epithelium means if it is present in a single layer of cell, means that is called a simple squamous epithelium, or otherwise if it is present in many layers, means that is called a stratified squamous epithelium. So stratified means layers. Same cuboidal epithelium, if it is present in single layer, means that is called a simple cuboidal epithelium. If it is present in many layers, means that is called stratified cuboidal epithelium. Stratified cuboidal epithelium. Third one is columnar epithelium. If the cilia is present in the outer surface of the columnar epithelium, means that is called ciliated columnar epithelium. Cilia means a hair like projection which is present in the outer surface, that is called ciliated columnar epithelium. And fourth one is glandular epithelium. Sometimes the normal epithelial cells get modified and converted into specialized glandular cells, that is called glandular epithelium. So this glandular epithelium used to secrete the substances. Such type of epithelial tissues are called glandular epithelium. It is found as a salivary gland and sweat gland. So next one is four types of connective tissue. Next one is connective tissue. Organs are used to connect the body parts. First one is blood. So blood is a fluid connective tissue. Blood is connect the each and every organs of our body. So blood has two types. Blood is a type of connective tissue. It connect all the parts of our body. The parts of blood. So blood has liquid part, that is called plasma. It is a colorless liquid. It contains protein, salt and hormones. So there are three types of blood cells are floating around in the plasma. They are RBC, WBC and platelets. RBC gives the red color to the blood. Its main function is transportation. It transports gases, digested food, hormones and waste materials. Next one is bone. It is a hard connective tissue. Blood is a fluid or liquid connective tissue. Bone is a hard connective tissue. It forms the framework of our body. It also anchors the muscles and support the organs. Bones are provide the proper shape. It forms the framework and supports the body. It also provide anchors the muscles and to the main organs of the body. Bones are very strong and non-flexible. Bone cells are embedded in a hard matrix that is composed. Is present in the ear, nose, trachea and larynx. So next two types of connective tissue is tendons and ligament. So tendons and ligaments also a connective tissue. The tendons is a connective tissue is used to connect the next tissue, connective tissue is adipose tissue. It is found below the skin and between the internal organ. Between the internal organ. Adipose tissue are filled with fat globules. Adipose mainly used to store fat molecules. It acts as an insulator. So next topic is muscular tissue. Muscular tissue consists of elongated cells or called muscle fibers. So muscular tissues are the responsible for the movement of our body. Mostly it consists of elongated cells. That elongated cells are known as muscle fiber. So that muscle fiber contains special proteins called contractile protein or myofibrin. So this contractile proteins, it enables the contraction and relaxation of muscles and causes the movement. Muscular tissues are divided into three categories based on their function. So types of muscular tissue: striated muscles, smooth muscles and cardiac muscles. Striated muscles, smooth muscles and cardiac muscles. First one is striated muscles. So striated muscles, it is attached with the bones. This is the most abundant muscles in our body. These skeletal muscles are also called as voluntary muscles. So striated muscles, it is also known as skeletal muscles and voluntary muscles. So why it is called as voluntary muscles means because these kind of muscles, muscle movement or happens as per our will. In order to our wish, we can move or we can stop the movement of our body. So such type of muscles are called skeletal muscles. So it is also termed as striated muscles. So why it is called as striated muscles means because when we observe these kind of muscles under the microscope means we can see alternative dark and light bands. So dark and light bands are striations. So striation means layers. So that's why it is called striated muscles. Then it is called as skeletal muscles. Why? Because means it is attached with skeleton or bones. That's why it is a skeletal muscles. So striated muscles, they are voluntary muscles, striated muscles. The size and shape of the muscles, striated muscles, they are long, cylindrical and branched and multinucleate. Multinucleate means single cell contain many nucleus. That is called as multinucleated. So the striated muscles means they are long cells. They have long cells, cylindrical in shape, unbranched and multinucleated cells. Next one is smooth muscles. Smooth muscles means it is also known as involuntary muscles. It is known as involuntary muscles and unstriated muscles. So unstriated muscle means there is no layers. It is found in alimentary canal, blood vessels, iris of the eye, in ureters and in the bronchi of the lungs. So the structure of smooth muscles, they are long, spindle shaped and uninucleate. Spindle shaped means broad in middle with two sharpened ends, that is called spindle shaped. And uninucleate means a cell contains only one nucleus, that is called uninucleated. And third one is cardiac muscles. So cardiac muscles means it is also known as involuntary muscles. So it works without our will. So cardiac muscles means that is a heart muscles. So it is present around the heart. It is a unique muscles found only in the walls of heart. They are responsible for rhythmic contraction and relaxation of heart throughout the life. The structure of cardiac muscles, they are cylindrical branched and uninucleated. The last topic is nervous tissue. So nervous tissue means the cells of the nervous tissue are highly specialized for being stimulated and then transmitting the stimulus very rapidly from one place to another within the body. Transmit stimulus very rapidly from one place to another. Nervous tissues are composed of three main components. They are brain, spinal cord and nerve cells. The cells of nervous tissue are called as nerve cell or neurons. The neuron, this is the building block of nervous system. It helps to receive and transmitting the stimulus. It consists of three parts. One is cell body, a soma. Second one is dendrites, axon and nerve ending. The parts of the neuron: cell body, axon, nerve ending and dendrite. Cell body contains cytoplasm and nucleus. Dendrites are short extension or hair-like projection that stretch out of the cell body. Axon is a long thread-like projection of the neuron. This is the longest cell in human body. So the coordination between nervous tissue and muscular tissue enables the organism to respond very rapidly to the stimulus. Thank you, students.